blind, huh?
I can't even see where's one of
And I'm hoping my story is going to be starting being one of the training partners I'd like to
do for an athlete. So, yeah, that's me. Have any more? Ask any questions?
We talk about sacrifices, and I think definitely Dee's has made some sacrifices. As she touched on, that she's been a teacher and been working for how many years? Full time for three years. And would you mind, can you touch on that too? I think this is a really good way to talk about sacrifices again. Talk about different levels.
I was faced with a really difficult reality. Well, not difficult at all, really. Do you want to play Pinky Bell Swiss? Yes. But at the point in which I was offered my training partnership last year, I've been a full time teacher for 3 years and worked at the school for four. I don't know if anyone works in the teaching industry, but getting full time permanency is not easy in Sydney, and I had a wonderful job at an all boys school in Mossman. And I was very reluctant to give up my permanency. From a long-term perspective, as you start to become a bit older, thinking about things like trying to get a home loan, giving up permanency is something quite scary. But naturally, I approached my boss and said, I have to do this. Since I was a little girl, it's my dream, and I can't let it go. I was blessed enough that I have an amazingly supportive boss, and I have taken a year's leave without pay from my permanent contract. And I'm actually on kind of like a sabbatical. And I effectively am only working 2 days a week, part-time, and I've moved back home with my parents to try and make my dream a reality. So, yeah, I'm lucky enough and fortunate enough to be blessed to have a headmaster at my school that is willing to give my job back in 2019, but I'm hoping he doesn't need to because this is for employees. So.
Awesome, thanks, Liz.
What a nice start. You don't worry about talking, you just went nuts. Right, you're up. Okay, so Dee is one of the most amazing public speakers ever, and I'm really
intimidated. Yeah, my story is a little bit different. Nowhere near as amazing as Dee's yet. I'm 20, so it's pretty much only just started, but I started my netball career quite late as a junior. I didn't start playing recs until I was under 14. Before that, I was playing lots of other sports like touch football, and I loved athletics, so I sort of just joined netball as like another one of the sports I could just get into. So yeah, I started playing Sydney Netball Academy. It was probably one of the best netball experiences I've had to date still. The girls I play with, I played with at that time, I'm still such good friends with. And without those girls, I couldn't have got through some of my toughest years so far. I think one of the lucky things about Academy is that you're not fighting against each other, you're actually there to play with each other and to learn about the game, to learn about being in the environment, all those things. At that time, I was actually put in a position where I needed to choose, like, as you guys probably all play lots of sports and have to make a decision eventually about which one is the best. And the reason I chose netball was because of the girl I played with. I would come to netball as an escape from my personal life, from what was going on at school, and as you guys probably know, at about this age, all your friends at school start their own parties and start having a really exciting social life, and you get sick of saying, no, I can't come, I've got training, or I have to get a meal tonight because I'm training tomorrow. And I think at that stage, the Netball Academy became my social life almost. Like, obviously, I still did things at school, but being able to hang out with girls that were so like-minded to me made it such an easy journey, and it made me so motivated to work hard and to be as good as the girls around me and to play with them. So from Sydney Netball Academy, I was given the opportunity to try for the state team, and I felt like what I'd learned at Sydney Netball Academy had actually set me up so well for the trial process. So they taught me like doing yoga, doing all those things, and being in the training environments, working hard in those sort of situations, really sets you up. So things that you're learning at the camps like this today and in your own academy sessions are so, like, I can't stress how valuable they are when it comes to trial and time. So yeah, from there I was lucky enough to make a state team, the top age 17 team. I missed out the year before, and one of my best mates, who I played lots of different sports with, she'd actually made the team. And so I got to see everything that she was doing without actually being the team. I watched her go to nationals, wear the blue dress, go to all these amazing training sessions with all these awesome coaches. And I decided that year there was nothing more I wanted to do than be in that state team. Put everything into it. Like, I knew we had to do the yo-yo test from Academy, so I would do the yo-yo test just in my backyard 3 or 4 times a week, just so I could be good at it. And we had a treadmill, and I would stick up a photo of the diamonds and then the state team, and I would run towards that as fast as I could, because I knew I wanted to be in that team so badly. I remember the exact moment that they put the team up on the website. I checked like, I reckon 50 times that day, if I would refresh, and I made it, and I just remember, I've never been that happy in my whole life. Like, even to this day, that was a, like, changing moment. Yeah, and from then I knew, like, netball was my life. I love netball. I would pretty much give up anything to be on the court and be playing with girls like I do, because the girls I play with, like these, actually inspire me every day to be as good as them. Anyway, so from there I made some other teams, which was awesome, but actually missed out on the under-21s Australian squad that got to go to Botswana, and that was a really big, not challenged, because obviously it's so hard to get into that team, but it was a bit of a setback. I really had my heart set on getting into that team, and two of my best friends were in that team, and they're amazing athletes and totally deserve to be in that team. But I would train them and support them as they were living something that I dreamed of for a few years now. Anyway, one of the biggest lessons I learned from that setback was you never know who's watching you. A few years before that, we had an opportunity as like a practice run to go to New Zealand as the under-19s. Gave me a reputation of not being the most organised person or not being fully committed to this like dream of getting to the under-21s team. And in netball, you don't get many opportunities to make a second impression. There are so many girls that are just as good as you at the time that if you do something like that, why should they pick you? And netball at selectors have to be quick to judge because they have so many of us to judge. So if I could give any of you advice, it would be that you never know who's watching, ever. Like, on and off the court, there could always be someone watching you. You don't know if there's someone listening to your conversation in the bathroom or if someone's watching you cool down, because they're the things that really matter when you're getting chosen above another girl that's probably just as talented as you. So always remember that there could be someone watching who is important. The only other thing I would say on from that is work out in academy and like start thinking about what makes you better than the girl next to you. What makes you better than the other wing attack that's in your team or in another team? And what are your things that are different? Because there are 10 good wing attacks, but could you be better than that? Is there something that makes you better? I know when I was starting to play girls and stuff, I knew I always wanted to be the girl that got like ran after every ball. I wanted to get every single loose ball. And I knew that I wanted to be the girl that could jump the highest. So even if I was not a netball, I used to walk around with my family, like I'd be walking down off the street, and I'd be trying to touch everything to make myself jump higher. Like every doorway I'd go through, jump so that I can be the highest jump on the court. Stuff like that that's going to make you stand out and make the selectors pick you. Anyway, I think that's probably it. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, so just on that jump, the rumors are apparently that you are like a machine. You've all seen it on Facebook, and I'm sure that. So how high can you actually jump?
No, she's not pretending she doesn't, but she will be knowing what her level is at home, she's still trying to be, even though she's probably thinking of what you've done.
I think I could be about 71 centimetres.
Yeah, so what's the average? Do you know what the average is? Okay, so we're going to put you on running. Why don't you guys get us on this? We're going to say around average is about 50, and currently jumping at 71. So that gives you an idea of her elevation. From a standing elevation, it's unbelievable. So those are always telling me what this pay off. So as you guys have seen, there's two, and this is why I wanted these two ladies here today, because they have similar but very different journeys in the same respect. I think that when you look at the dedication that's there, and as I said, they're both super dedicated athletes, I love the fact that it sort of relates back to you guys, exactly what Plummer was just saying there, that if you're missing a team, what are you going to do to actually make yourself get into that next team? And again, it might be from a representative team back in your home association, it might be to the academy, or it might be into a state team, and so on, as your playing or umpiring pathway goes through from 2018. But it's just going to show you that you girls sitting here today, and that's something that I hope that you can take out this whole weekend, depending on what you actually want to take from this academy program and what you want to take from each session that you listen to, whether sometimes you might get distracted and not listen, it's what you guys take out of each session is what's going to make you a better athlete. And I'm sure you guys will agree that it's not just being about better athletes, it's about being a better person in life in general, as you get older with our jobs and everything. Netball has such a big impact on our lives in every different aspect, so I think that's something that you really need to look at. Okay, so at the moment we've got obviously between our 14 and 16 year olds. We only have bottom age child of the 17s, they're not top age yet, and there's still some young girls coming through the pathway. So is there any other piece of advice you would like to give them?
Yeah, I mean after that, naturally it's probably easy to ask questions and we'll respond to those questions individually. Because I think advice is a really broad spectrum. I think what Marty touched on and would be my first piece of advice is, yes, you are a netballer, and for us at this stage, our career is probably the biggest part of our world, but I think some of the best advice I got very early on is you will not be a successful athlete until your whole pie, again, how you're looking at your life-work balance, how you're looking at yourself as a person holistically, until all of that is in balance and in place. So if netball is 100% of everything that makes you you, and that is probably going to be commonplace for where you're at, and that's probably what makes you the passionate, amazing, and upcoming netballers that you are. If it's everything though, that means that your sense of self, your sense of satisfaction, the way in which you're judging every day depends on the outcome of one thing. And I think to be resilient, it has to be the most important thing to you. You've got to have other things in your world that keep you balanced. So your schooling, you still need to dedicate as an athlete, you should be dedicated to your academic studies. You need to make sure you make time for family because they're the people that are always there when you're selected or not selected. You need to remain balanced in all those things as well. So knowing who you are as an athlete and making sure you've got other things that make you you away from the court, I think is really important. But in saying that, some of the best advice I ever got as a young athlete, so when I was still a teenager, and a life coach now for me, who was busy at the time, said, I was complaining to him about girlfriends going out, me not having a social life, and always feeling a little bit different, feeling like I couldn't be the athlete to go to the birthday party, or I couldn't be the girl that was able to do drink alcohol when everyone else was, all those sorts of things. He said, Nikki, you spend your entire adolescence trying to be like everyone else, and then every adult spends the rest of their adult life trying to figure out how to be different, and how to make themselves stand out and be an individual and have something to be really proud of that makes them them. You have this amazing opportunity as a young athlete to figure out who you are really quickly. I think sport brings the pressure of life to you sooner than most people, and you figure out who you are and how you respond under pressure and what really makes you tick. So yeah, two pieces of advice is make sure your life is balanced, but don't take for granted the privilege you have to already set up a definition of the type of person you want to be and the type of people you want to surround yourself with. Because sitting where you are is already a privilege that someone else doesn't have. And if you're sitting in that grandstand today thinking, oh, I want to be somewhere else, or disappointed that you're here and not somewhere else, don't point blame at those people. Take ownership for the fact that you're still very lucky to be sitting where you are, and there's always someone that wants to see what you have. So keep chasing the next one, but always be grateful for the one that you have at the moment as well.
And just on that, as obviously all these girls know, the academy program is working on an individual athlete. And we touched on before about, I think sometimes because we become friends, that we don't challenge each other enough in our own environments to make sure that when we're doing any of our sessions, you need to make sure that same position is one of your best friends. You need to, for their benefit as well as your own, you need to challenge each other. You definitely agree with that. Awesome. I just want to touch on with you guys as well. All these girls obviously doing the yo-yo test. So can you girls, obviously I don't think anyone really is super excited to do it, except maybe you two. So can we just potentially have a little bit of a chat and let these girls know what the little guys are at to something we were actually aspiring to?
She wouldn't want to stop before me, and I'm not stopping until she does, so it'd be a big day.